be some video and audio recording. Any member who's got an issue, please let me know. So before we start the meeting, and the protocol is the recording starts at the beginning of the meeting, I've got some preliminary things to say. Fire alarm! With fire officers here, we're very glad if there is a fire alarm, that we will be in good hands. Follow the exit points, the nearest exit, and to the assembly points, which are in the main car park. No smoking for meeting. Toilets are located on this corridor. Leaving the meeting, obviously take your equipment, switch off any recording equipment. Privacy and confidentiality. Anybody who has a personal, private or confidential information, please do not leave that on display, obviously, while recording is taking place. Right, mobile phones, please switch those off. So with that done, I'll move on and I'll open the meeting. The meeting's now open, you can start the recording. We've got one or two members who are, well, one member particularly who's trying to get into the car park is coming. We have apologies so far none received from members of this committee. Are there from members any declarations of interest?
I think perhaps due to the statement for myself, need to declare a non-pecuniary interest in the item on sort of fire help because we're both trustees of the charity.
So that's appendix 8, item 8. Okay, thank you. There's only one item of exempt nature, which is item 9, station mergers, confidential, it's commercially confidential information. We'll just pause when we get to that point to allow press and public to leave. Right, so then we'll move on then to the main agenda. So that's item 2, minutes of the previous meeting, pages 1 to 4. There in the printed agenda. Any corrections or alterations? If not, can I take that as agreed? So we move on to item 3, pages 5 to 38, financial review. So that's 14-15 in September, current year. If we'd like to go through this, I think Kieran will lead us through that. Kieran.
Thanks, Chair. This is just your regular financial review, which obviously is a health check of all aspects of the financial management. And I suppose it's quite nice for me to bring a bit of good news for a change. So we're a bit ahead of schedule in terms of delivering savings. And in essence, what the report from a revenue point of view is saying is that we're over 1.6 million to the good in this financial year, which is obviously pleasing news. The main areas where that 1.6 million has arisen from is there is a half million saving in staff costs. So we're a bit ahead of the game in terms of delivering savings there. There's been a reduction in the pension costs for staff in the local government pension scheme of 300,000. Tight management of government budgets right across the piece has saved about £465,000. And then, as you can see in the treasury management section of the report, reductions in the debt servicing costs and close cash management has saved about £400,000 net of loss of income on balances. It's probably worth, in terms of the savings, just drawing your attention to page 9 of the report, which is a big table we give you every time, which sort of summarises the savings target we've got for this spending review. And you can see that up to the end of 2015-16, the total value of approved savings is £21.9 million across the spending review period. And all but £1.1 million of that is now fully implemented. So we're well on track to get those savings in place. And then moving beyond that for the final elements of the savings that are required around the financial plans, the key elements of that are around the four station mergers that we plan eventually. And obviously, work is ongoing around those. So that's the revenue side of things. That £1.6 million we're ahead of the game. The proposal is that that's inside in the capital investment reserve to help contribute towards the station merger project. Moving on to the capital section of the report. Again, two bits of good news in short succession, most unlike me. We've had good news on the capital grant bid for the Transformation Efficiency Fund. We've received just short of £4.5 million, which is more than you'd expect on the sort of proportionality test. That's very good news, and that's to support the station mergers programme. In terms of the capital programme, we've added in the first of those station mergers, which is a heightened and listed at Prescott, because obviously we've finished the public consultation there, and you know, having heard the public's views, that merger was finally approved at the meeting in September, and so that's now included in the capital programme. Alongside that, there's a little bit of rephasing of the refurbishment works on stations that aren't involved in the project. That's just been rephased across the years, so that's moved about £3 million from the current year's programme to future years. There's some small variations to the Joint Historical Centre project, which will be subject to a separate report, and the authorities will go through it in detail. And some of the specific ICT systems which are being set in place to replace the soft logic system have been included in the capital programme, and that's been funded from reserves that have been set aside previously. You will be getting a full report on the what's called the application replacement strategy, so the strategy for replacing all our software in the very near future. So I'll be able to get some report. In terms of treasury management, we've received the pension grant. We've got a high level of reserves, so on page 16, it gives you an idea of the level of investments that you had at the end of September, which for those two reasons is particularly high. So our level of investments at the end of September was £29.1 million, and obviously we reinvest that in line with our strategy to minimise risk to the authority. There's been no need for any additional borrowing because of those available cash reserves. Despite the fact that the high levels of reserves, I suppose the other thing I'd say is that we're getting a relatively low level of return on those investments, but it's still around about double the rate of return we get if we weren't proactively managing those investments, although I'm looking forward to doing it tomorrow. Total audit, nothing major to bring to your attention there. There's a pretty important review on procurement issues, which will come back to the audit committee. In terms of monitoring financial processes, good performance across the piece, and that draws your attention there. So let's quick whistle through. Good news once from me, and happy to take any questions.
Are there any questions from members?
Comment,
if you don't
mind, I've been actually
spend the money now. If there's no other question particularly, I think we should point out that whilst on page 16 it says we've got 29.1 million, I don't think that's just all sitting there ready to be spent on, you know, something that we haven't decided yet. Most of that is set aside for, you know, things that they're all hypothecated. It's all, you know, for the smoothing reserve and building reserve and that so forth. So it's not as though we've got free money that we can just do anything with.
I think, Chair, just to add to that, I mean, one of the biggest issues is that we received the pension grant for paying the pensions of the retired firefighters in advance. So, you know, in the early part of the year, we suddenly receive a big block of cash, which we then have to invest. That's used across the year, so that's one of the major contributing factors.
And also, on the chart on page 16, it deals with credit ratings of the organisations. There are a number there which are major financial institutions which are unrated. And I generally do ask this question, and there are new members here, I'll come back in a moment. But could you just confirm to us why we are allowed, you know,
to address these unrated interventions. It's to do with the way the ratings are set up, and you'll note they're all building societies, so the rating arrangements for building societies are slightly different, and your rules allow investments up to £1 million in building societies within this.
So it's not as though we're taking a risk. It's quite allowed, it's quite regulated. Okay, so are there any other questions on this item? Okay, so before we move on to, now that all members are present and people coming in, I'd just like to introduce to the committee Councillor Ray Halpin, who's here. This is your first meeting. Welcome to the Fire Authority, and I know, because all the rest of us will think, you're going to have a great time on the authority because we do special things. So, I hope you will find it difficult to understand everything at first, but any questions, any of us I'm sure would like to help you out with your understanding and to be involved in the life of the authority. Anyone? Thank you. So we move on to item 4, Treasury Management Interim Report, pages 39 to 46.
Thanks, Chair. I won't elaborate on this report because most of the information was contained within the previous financial review. It's just best practice to have a twice a year review of Treasury Management specifically, as it happened that fell with the financial review that was coming. So there's a bit of duplication of the information here, but happy to take any questions specifically about Treasury Management.
This is the report everyone's come for. All this important shut-ups and tables and all the rest of it. This is the meatiest bit. Well, as always, we're very fortunate, and we get all of the audits for being in control of our finances. So, are there any questions? Thank you very much. That's good. So we move on to appendix 5, voluntary severance, grey book. Pages 47 to 52.
Thanks, Chair. There's been a report to the attention of members, really, and I'll talk about specific recommendations shortly, and then some reasons why we're not pursuing this at this moment in time. What has been to members' attention, the authority agreed on the 26th of June 2014 to consider the use of voluntary servants for firefighters, given some of the clearly financial challenges facing us. But equally, we're trying to recognise the fact that we provide voluntary servants for our green book members and staff. And on a number of occasions, we've had members of uniforms as part of the service who have equally expressed a kind of an appetite to pursue voluntary servants. And whether by exploring those opportunities, there will be opportunities for the authority to make some savings in relation to managing the transition from the number of firefighters we currently have to the number we will require in the future. But as a result of that, we need to have a piece of work to consider the legal implications of that, because there have been some legal barriers to facilitating this previously, but some recent changes have allowed us to consider the game. So the purpose of the report is to update members on the potential, especially the importance of the potential use of voluntary servants to lead to firefighters as a mechanism to achieve the required savings to meet the ongoing financial challenge faced by the authority. And that the recommendations are that members note the contents of the report and the potential to use voluntary servants for grey book staff as well as green book staff to achieve those budget savings. Approve the approach advanced in this report regarding the management of applications for voluntary servants, and delegate responsibility for the management of such applications to the chief fire officer in the same way as non-firefighting staff in order to best meet the future staffing requirements. So they are the recommendations of the report. However, what we will also recommend that we have previously avoided the use of voluntary servants and firefighters due to the fact that we have no one being able to manage our retirement rates and the natural turnover of staff, albeit there has been an appetite for some staff given the change in organisation that they would pursue voluntary servants or the opportunity to pursue that personally. But there have been some legal barriers to applying that in the same way as the local government pension scheme has been applied, but that has been addressed more recently, and we've sought legal advice on whether we can now pursue that in a different way to achieve that. So despite move the approach to recognise that it's applicable under certain circumstances for the business case and delegate responsibility to the managers to switch applications to the chief fire officer in the same way as the government of that removal of staff, respectful staff, and for that policy. Happy to take any questions for sure, Chair.
Currently, the policy the authority has got in place is to offer twice the statutory minimum as part of the authority policy in trying to avoid compulsory redundancies. So that's what we apply to the uniform staff. So if it were used for the uniform staff, take the same approach, but it would be twice the statutory minimum, which broadly speaking is about 4 weeks pay, maybe a service. Thank you.
bridge between where they are now and being able to draw the pension. The pension age moving on, but some of them maybe planned to go at 55, 56, 57. Now to see themselves unable to do that because of the change in pension age, and maybe looking at this, but really, as in all of our authorities, we have to make a case and we have to demonstrate to our auditors that we've gone through the proper process. As we do in all of our councils as well. So I think if there's no more points on that, it's the recommendations, as Betty said, page 47, 2A to C. This is to give the officers flexible power to deal with any voluntary retirement should they arise, and should there be in the interest of the service to do so, financial interest. So be agreed.
Agreed.
Right, that's confirmed. Thank you very much. So that's item five. Item five. Moving on to six, introduction to apprenticeships, 53 to 62.
Thanks, Chair. Kate said he's introduced to a few stories, so I think it's a pretty good time. I think this is an exceptionally good news story for the authority. Here's the report is to request that members approve the introduction of workplace apprenticeships within the service, and the recommendation is very similar that the members approve the introduction of six apprenticeships within the prevention function of the service. And I think it's probably tube opportunity here. It's just getting it right and getting the structures organisation correct.
Yes, thanks to you. Again, as my colleagues have said, this is a great new story. Thanks for that. But, my background's in youth work and youth dependent work. This resonates with me, particularly the fact that I have been involved in with the British Trust in different guises in the region, of course. And to see some of our most vulnerable young people, and as Councillor Alpin has alluded to, these are some young people who, in some cases, cannot read or write, or the education system gave up on them a long time ago. Some of them were looked after children as well, and they're now looked after adults, and they come into the system. And this, whilst we can't say it's a good social media recruitment ground for our apprentices, what it will be though, it's hope for some of them on the Bridges Trust, that there's something that's tangible, that's within their grasp. Because I've seen at the passing out ceremonies of the Bridges Trust how some young people and young adults have grown from the day they were cajoled into coming onto the programme in some cases. In fact, our staff go along the chapel of the stairs to tell them to get out of bed. And they've turned up and they've completed the 12-week course, and it's been the most positive thing that they've done in their lives. And for some of them, it's the first time they've been recognised. And I think this is an absolute, and I'm glad that we're talking about our own programme. I'm sorry we're only looking at six. You know, because I'd like to be saying, why aren't we looking at 60? I know it's impossible, but let's be aspirational as well, and let us aim for the stars as well, because I think our young people are absolutely worth it, and what we've already got in place, we're well suited to be able to deliver it, so I fully recommend it.
Thank you,
that's all. Thanks, Shane. Just from the meeting we had in St. Anne's Street Fire Station, because of the proximity and talks of a lot of the firefighters felt that there should have been a bit more of a focus on the BME community as well. So, I know this is a Lord Sand thing. What I'd like to see if this can be pushed out a bit more to the BME, because they are really left out in the city. Also, are you getting any remuneration from the government?
First two bits, if you ask this from the remuneration board, basically the apprenticeship model, and we'll come back to the kind of our recruitment process, which the fact that we were looking to recruit across the gender and the BME communities, part of our apprenticeship, which is ongoing currently, is absolutely the same model that we apply for apprentices, and we want to encourage apprentices to reflect down and make this happen. Opportunity would be fantastic, but just in case this is
we had good success with the Prince's Trust scheme and when we built the hub for its apprenticeships, modern apprenticeships, we've tried in all of our contracting, in all of our major, and there'll be more, another discussion on this perhaps later, later in the agenda. But, you know, we have had, as an authority, a commitment to try to include all we do apprenticeships. Now, I had a report, interestingly, yesterday, Council, you alluded to this, from the Combined Authority Scrutiny Committee. They must have met earlier in the week or last week. And there is, this is another line that we've been looking at, which was trying, we are subscribed to the Merseyside European Office, but we don't fully understand exactly everything that we're supposed to be getting out of that. And I think that maybe with the advent of the Combined Region, and Combined Authority of the Bootle region, and the onward pressure for devolution, and us wanting to be part of that devolution on a city and county basis, we don't want to be washed into any big picture. We need to play that role. And one of the things we can bring to the table, to the other authorities in Merseyside, is a good experience of modern apprenticeships and getting people into that. It may well be that through some of our members, because I believe that those we actually are on this regeneration and on the leaving the money out of Europe, it's those who that sort of take the delegation on that, and it would be very useful to try and send messages back. If we've not drawn all the money down from Europe, is there some way that the fire authority could tap into that? Because we'd like to see more apprenticeships as a way of operation. And so I think as using our informal contacts and networks, maybe we could look into some more of that type of stuff. And at some stage, this is one of the things that the leadership of the authority would like to see. We probably need to have a report back from the Merseyside office people again. At some stage, it must have been at least 18 months to 2 years before we've heard from them. And one of the things we can ask them is about this sort of employment initiative to, you know, try and engender development within Merseyside and those sorts of things. It's work program, isn't it? Work for the next year. Okay, so, Catherine Lloyd?
No, just
to say,
it's
2007, 2007, in January, 4 years. So, well, it's time that we have him back. Yeah. And I think that will be, you know, that possibly to the, I don't know, well, one of the three committees, the authority of the maybe sort like that, and get them to come back and talk about it, give us an update on what the situation is. So, if there's no other points or questions on this item 6, on page 53 is the recommendation at 2. Is that agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. So, we move on to 7, which is the Merseyside Police Estate Strategy, page 53, 92.
I think you're all well aware that the Police and Crime Commissioner has had a strategy launched around the estate strategy. And in essence, it's about rationalising police buildings and making more efficient use of their estate. And of course, we've been doing from that consultation process. And I suppose it's nice to be sitting in the best example of joint working and great use of shared estates in this very building, in this very room of the Joint Command and Control Centre. And I've included page 91, just a little map that we put together of sort of police and fire assets, and you know, you can very quickly look at that and start seeing opportunities for working together. You know, you can spot little red dots close together in the form of being moving the windows and so on, and you think that there are opportunities arising from that. So what I'm proposing is a response from the chair of the authority to Jane Kennedy, you know, responding positively to the work they're doing around the estate. Reflecting that there's a strong expectation from the public about we like partners working together, and that building on the excellent work done here at the JCC, we ought to be a partner of choice effectively, and we ought to try and look for those quick wins that will help the taxpayers right across Merseyside. A short and sweet response on that basis. Happy to take any questions.
Colleagues, questions? Points?
Chair, yes, not so much a question as an observation. Speaking of the opposition to this in the presentation, we've got the proposals that we've got after the proposals and the proposals and we've given all these little figures and that. So after the proposals on this one, the Liverpool one, just looking at it here. Now it's an observation that I need to make here because I do think in my personal capacity outside of stress outside of disability, I do have some concerns because it's after the proposals does show that there will be three custody suites. It's actually going through roads and now there. Belvedere has already gone. And waiting to know what is going on. And that was reported to the office manager. We had said this manager 2 weeks ago. So after the proposals it will look like that. We will have one custody suite in Liverpool and that's St. Town Street. And that's been borne up by the area commander, well, the police commander who will be taking over the role of the two BCU that we've got together. And that's mentioned by the Oxfam review. Whilst we're sending letters of support for things, we may be supporting things that are not quite right at this moment in time. That's all we're saying.
I think my reading of this is this report, you know, we're all interested as councillors in how the policing and motor services we're all interested. In every one of our districts, this is a controversial report, and there's things like close Crosby Police Station, close Southport Police Station. All of these things are individually controversial in our own patch. I think what we're saying is, you know, Commissioner, no matter what the outcome of your negotiations and your consultation with the community and with the leaders of the community and the local authorities, if you want synergy between the blue light services, there's an open offer. I mean, we've got fire stations co-located with your police stations. If you want to come in with us on a deal, you know, there's an open door to do that. And that's all the same. That's it. You know, it's controversial in the communities, and the councils and the wards represent the communities. We're just looking at fire operation, and also, you know, for bang for the buck, if we've got four people, police station over there, an old tatty building from the 1900s. And over here, literally, a step across the road, is a brand new building with spare capacity. Why don't they move in there? You know, it just makes sense. So it's basically saying to the commissioner, and we've said this to her. I mean, but the police are, as we found on the Wirral recently, with our proposed changes, you can get into a time of considerable public reflection, you know, the spotlight is shining down on you. I think all the proposal here is to send a letter saying, okay, do you know what? There's a formal offer here to try and co-locate with us if you'd like to.
Thank you. I understand how the rents and the same that I have in my own area of caring. But you're right in what you're saying, that this is two set of problems. I was not to start off with an issue there.
Sure,
yeah, with a new build. Yeah, except that, but that's what I've been doing at the moment. It doesn't make sense to use a colleague okay together, which just makes it easy. If you move one away from that area, that causes problems. Council members might individually work on our own issues like this, but again, it's an offer that if you put two, it's part of the consultation process. And hopefully, if you don't take that on board,
well, you know, again, we've all read the report. We've picked out, you know, I've not read the report about the Wirral or, you know, Marxist Pellings. You concentrate on your own part, what effect is going to be inception and that. So each area will have its own implications, but in most of them, they're basically saying, well, why don't you use the library? Why don't you use the community centre? rather than saying, actually, just up the road there is an ambulance station or there is a police station, there's a fire station, we'd like to get on board with the other blue light services. I think that's strand in that document that the Commission's put out. It's an open goal that's been missed in the way. And it's just highlighting that to them, that rather than going into the library, although I think we understand how the Commissioner is phasing this, because it's saying to the community, we want to be open, we want to be, you know, in those places where you are, and if you are in the library, we want to be in there with you as well. I understand all that. But actually, there's another side to this which hasn't been properly expressed in the report, perhaps. When we spoke to her about this, and she knows, I think, is, you know, why don't you consider some of the police fire stations as well? So, there's no other points. The recommendation here is to note that these proposals, page 63, item 2, and with those comments that have been made, would that be agreed? So, the next is 8, talks of fire pit of annual report. There are, which is page 93 to 118, with two members giving non-pecuniary interest.
Thanks, Chair. I think most members, with the exception of the Council of Health and Toxic Use, are very familiar with the Toxic and the concept of the youth zone alongside the fire station, which is working tremendously well. And I suppose what I thought was, as we prepared the first year of accounts for a charitable company that's been set up to run the youth zone, it seemed to make sense to bring those accounts formally to the authority and give a little bit of an update to that. I know you have a learning lunch, which Sarah Walton presented out a couple of weeks back, and a number of you were at, so I think you've got most of the information there. But I suppose if you look at the first year of operation, paragraphs sort of 8 onwards give some of the highlights, and 22 staff, during the build phase, weights as the builders, 8 apprenticeships were generated just during the build phase, which were very proud of. Then as the charity was set up and started recruiting, 22 staff were taken on, two-thirds of whom were from the LA postcode, and they were certainly representative of the local community, which is, I think Merseyside's the largest community by some logic. And also 9 young people who employed and are working as youth hosts, and quite a large proportion of them were around employed previously, so very good news. In terms of membership of young people, there are actually over 2,000 members now, about 1,800 at the time of writing, and in that particular financial year, 73,000 visits across the year to the youth. And charity, these things are always a bit, you take the credit for everything, but the charity reports that it's contributed to a 40% reduction in youth crimes and a significant reduction in antisocial behaviour around bonfire nights. I think in truth, despite being a trustee of the charity, you can't claim all the credit because it's a multi-agency approach, but still very good news. And Hubs worked with the education partner and for 960 qualifications in the year. So a really good news story. Perhaps we should forget that obviously Sarah Orton was with voted as a side woman of the year as well, which is a big accolade for her.
That's good for us.
So really good news, really good work that's going on. However, I suppose I've just put a word of caution in that the business plan for the charity company was focused around an increase in generating income from sports facilities that are on site effectively by getting older members of the community and community groups to use those facilities. And, in truth, that business plan hasn't accelerated at quite the rate that we hoped. Nothing to panic about, but as trustees on the board, it's something you have to give serious consideration to about. But if that's not the way it's going to work, how can we make it work? And having looked at the options that are available, we've looked in particular at the on-site model, which I think most members would be aware of. In the Bolton Latin Girls Club, which is the original youth club, and they sort of across 30 years developed a model for running the youth zone there, which they thought this is a fantastic thing. We can spin it out and run that in a similar way across other youth zones. And they set up a charitable consultancy effectively on site to do that. And they've now set up 6 across the Northwest. And in essence, their funding model isn't based on training, it's based on some income from the authorities who are involved.
large proportion of the income coming from wealthy benefactors being involved in just donating money, either as companies or as wealthy individuals. We think that is probably the best model for the youth zone to look at moving forward. We've been involved in quite detailed conversations with the Cabinet Office on site themselves and the City Council about how we might do that. So it's just to bring that to members' attention. But I don't think it's a significant departure from how we've set things up, because the on-site model is based on a charitable company in exactly the same way, but it's important to bring that to your attention. And so that those conversations are carrying on as we move forward. And in paragraphs of 21 through to 32, it sets out a strategy of how the authority is supporting the movement and how it can support the authority, support the charity in moving to Merseyside model. I think it's probably best about stop there and take questions from members. To a degree, I think it's true. If you look at all the youth zones, I think when you look at their membership, or any of the on-site youth zones, as you'd expect, a large proportion of the membership comes from the immediate locality. However, when you've got world-class facilities, it is a possibility to draw in people from across the county, across the city, and certainly talks to. I think, speaking as a trustee now, to say we've done some good work around that. We do have membership spread right across Liverpool and even the world, I believe. But, however, I think there is more to do to build upon that. It's almost in this fledgling stage, and there is more work to be done to draw in people right across the county. But there are some good networks that are brilliant, because, for example, there is a youth zone nosy. There's a very different sort of demographic there, and there are relationships between Totsford and Mersey that getting the young people to interact. So I suppose, in summary, it's a work in progress, but there are good steps in the right direction.
Those members who may not have been there, you will be blown away. It's something special to progress. Try to put this development together. Basically, it's a sports learning centre and a fire station. It's like put that building in there. And our firefighters do put the role model in and all that sort of stuff. But it was based on very, very collaborative financing. The City Council, ourselves, and so forth. Then along came college, and there's lots of things happening there, But I think that whilst we're promoting it for young people, obviously it's a facility for the areas. There's leisure centres, there's health facilities, lots of them, it's just going to support the community in that area, and it should do. Support the community in that community in need. And also, there's been a lot of demolition around there. I think if you drive up the main road, you can see right across to the building now. A lot of the houses in the front, I think, have been demolished or cleared. I don't know what's happened there, really. So, there's a lot of change in that community in that area, and we need to give help and support. You know, the number of kids and young people going in to do some, you know, catering and community business, going to the college, and the after college, and all those sorts of things. But I suppose if people get involved in, like, the boxing nerds, the footballer, all these other sports, and they get into a particular club, they will travel some distance to attend that particular event that's using or being hosted at the club. So I think it is innovative. It is one of those areas where we've shown community commitment as well, and we just need to see how this thing develops. But I would very much encourage any members, anyone new certainly, new colleagues, to go and familiarise yourself. Very, very surprised.
Thanks, Ian. Like anything else, I have an old concept sort of. You've got big values now, but you won't get people off one area to another if you want to endorse that. But we've got a lot of people close to you know, especially the gymnastics on the Bedford Park Road.
Can be territorial, but it depends on the offer.
what state for young people? Like, if we've got something dynamic, something that's exciting, young people will travel to that. But we haven't got it. But it's a crap new club where it's your state of tennis, and you're into 10 o'clock, you can have a cup of tea, you can sit on the lounge and couch, watch the telly, and go home at 10 o'clock. It's not attractive. There's bigger things outside. But this is offering so many activities throughout the week. I think it's established, it's well known, it's run really well, it's providing an absolute service to the local community. However, it can provide an even bigger service, because I think we're at that level, we're on that journey, it's now the next stage up. And I think it is to do with the programme, it is to do with the working clubs across the piece, across Merseyside, which is good. I'm pooling resources, because the days of us all having plenty of money in our wards, youth and children's facilities, they're well gone. So it's how we put it together, how we provide a package that's exciting to the young people. Because you put it on, or we put it on, and they will come every time. And the fact that we've actually, raised our clock to the master or whatever, and said that we will have this in that particular area, it's a win-win situation.
Have you noticed
it's always
happened to
say
young people
will
travel?
Okay. Well, is there anything else that conclusion wise? Otherwise, page 93.2, that's the recommendation, is to note and endorse the strategy of the on-site funding model at B.
Yeah.
Is that agreed?
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Well, that's the open part of the meeting. We'll pause now.